Revelation 21, first verse. And if you have it, please stand on your feet with me. We're going to read the first seven verses. Then I have more scripture, but we will sit down. But just for honoring the word of the Lord, those that can, please stand. And I will read in your hearing. And it reads, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall no more death. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, neither crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away.' And he that sat upon the throne said, 'Behold, I make all things new.' And he said unto me, 'Write these words. Write, for these words are true and faithful.' And he said unto me, 'It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto them that is a thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely.'" Somebody say, "It's free." He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." Hallelujah. How many of you all know we're talking about heaven? Amen. We're talking about heaven. Pearly gates. Now, there's various different images of someone's imagination, what heaven will be like. Some are more majestic than these. But everybody wants to go there. So, but that's not what we're talking about. Tell your neighbor, that's not what we're talking about today. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for this moment in time that you've blessed me to be able to speak unto your people. Speak, Lord, to me that I will hear your words. And Lord, that I will speak with clarity, with understanding. Lord, so that souls will be delivered, that somebody will say, "Fill me with your precious gift, Lord. Save me." And that they will be saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. My father, as we all know, the founding pastor of this church, Elder Arthur G. Kearney Sr., he said this at least one time that I know of, and it just stuck with me ever since a little boy. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. You have to be prepared to get into it. It's the only place you have to go, you have to be prepared for to get into. Heaven. We all know the streets of gold, transparent gold. The walls, all the jewels, and the peace, and just being forever with the Lord and having our glorified bodies. There's lots of talk about heaven. There's lots of people, there are funerals that happen every day, and people talk about, "Well, I thank the Lord because my aunt, they're looking down on me from heaven." Everybody that dies, according to the mainstream, is they're going to heaven. I had a coworker, a loved one of theirs died, and they came in the next day and said that, "I know he's looking down on us today, and we're going to have a good day today because he's looking down on us." You know, there's so many false or just misunderstandings. So, but that's heaven. Again, tell your neighbor, he's not talking about that today. Revelations 20 and 10. Today, what we're going to talk about today is not a popular subject. It's not something that's going to get huge ratings amongst the mainstream media and across the world, because no one likes to talk about this. Today, we're going to talk about a subject that everybody needs to know about, and it's called the Lake of Fire. The Lake of Fire. You can call it hell, Lake of Fire. Often we will tell them to go there, or get it out of my face, or get it out of here, or shut it up. We just use it as a terminology. Throw it out there, you know. And like I said, we will tell people to go there. You can go straight to. Well, if you have a revelation of hell, you wouldn't want anybody to go there. I don't care how badly they've hurt you, how badly they talked about you, what they did to a loved one. If you have a revelation of hell, you wouldn't want anyone to go there. This place was designed for one purpose only: to punish Satan and the angels that sinned against God. But the Bible tells us that now hell is what? Enlarging itself. Jesus has made a way for escape for us not to go to this place. He's made a way. He paid the price. He paid the price. And now it's freely given for a ticket out to get in to those pearly gates. But let's talk a little bit deeper. We're going to go a little bit deeper in this. Again, I'm just talking with you today. I know we already shouted, we praised God and everything, but this is something that each and every one of us have got to have inside of us. We've got to have an understanding. If anything else, as I say, this is something that you need to know and to get down. Revelations 20 and 10. And it reads, "And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and forever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them." There's going to come a time when everybody is going to come before this throne room of judgment. There are going to be people that are going to try to flee from it, try to hide from it, but no one is going to escape. No one. This great white throne room of judgment. Now again, here's a picture of an artist made, of what it may be like seeing Jesus on the throne. The Bible tells us that the saints are going to judge the world. We are going to judge the angels, the demons that sinned from the beginning. We are going to judge them. This is in your Bible. And the Bible says there's going to be two scrolls or two books opened up that we're going to be judged from. There's one particular book called the Book of Life. The Book of Life. if your name is not in the book of life. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You want your name in the book of life. We're going to talk about what happens if my name is not there. Because there will be people saying, wait, wait, look again. My name is there. Thank you, Lord. Revelations 20 and 12 says, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. And another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. What have you been doing? Have you been preparing yourself? Have you prepared yourself for the prepared place? Some of us, the world today, they are busy. They are working. But what are they working for? Brother John, what are you working for? Mom, Dad, Elder Evangelist, what are you working for? I have to ask myself, what am I working for? Do not think just because we're here on Sunday morning and I sing the song, I do my dance, I play the drums, I do the keys, I preach, and dare I say, I lay hands and cast out devils. The Bible says that even those will cry out, Lord, Lord, didn't I cast out devils in your name? Didn't I praise you? Didn't I worship God? I was here. But he says, Jesus himself, the merciful one, the kind one, full of love, grace, and peace, he will say, depart from me. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. You know, when someone says depart from me, that sounds just so, I'm disgusted with you. You rejected me. I loved you so much that I bled for you. They ripped me into pieces. They tore out my beard. I took on the cruelest and most agonizing death known to man for you. And you rejected me. Time and again, you heard the preacher say, come to Jesus. He loves you. And you sat. I heard that before. Don't be in that throne room by saying, let me hear one more time, Jesus, I'll accept you now. By then it'll be too late. The God of grace, mercy, and peace, his countenance will be changed upon you. Depart from me. Ye that work iniquity, be gone. Because of the works that we chose. Next verse. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. If you've ever never seen, if you've ever been in the Navy, they have burial at sea. And they will take the draped coffin, the flag, and they'll push it over. Take the flag, fold it, bring it back to the family. Millions of people shipwrecked, lost at sea, eaten by man-eating sharks. The Bible says the sea will give up the dead, and even they will be judged. And it says, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. See, when we die, Brother Al, it's not just over. We go to a place. Jesus talked about it, on how the poor man, Lazarus, went and had rest in Abraham's bosom. The rich, wicked man did not. We'll talk about that another time. 20:15 says, and whosoever was not found written. Remember when I said, your name needs to be written in the book of life. And whosoever, why? Because whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, I want you to picture this. Now, I'm a visual type of guy, so that's why I use the type of visual aids for you. Just imagine what that'll be like. Often people will think, well, I'm going to go in with my mama, my daddy. We're all going to come in holding hands, and God is going to judge us together. No, 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 no. Like the commercial says, oh, no, my brother, you've got to get your own salvation. So imagine billions of people waiting for their turn to go into the throne room. Seeing your old friends that passed on years ago, you see them. Hey. And now you're just, okay, I'm going in now. And you're waiting for your name. You don't know whose name is going to be next. Billions of people waiting to go in. Now, so this place that we're talking about being cast into, first of all, I don't want to go there. Who wants to go there? Or who's lining up their hands and has already bought their advance ticket? My question is, have you? Do you already have a paid ticket? The movie Infinity Wars just came out, and I'm a big Marvel Universe MCU fan. And we're told about how the tickets were sold in advance. Anybody here a Marvel fan? Anybody? This is just me. That's okay. I know we're in church. You can sing. Yeah. Sorry. Pastor Williams, you a Marvel fan? Yeah. Thank you. See, that's why he's just a pastor. But the tickets were bought in advance, sold out. Weeks, months in advance. So their ticket is already punched and ready to go. The crazy thing about hell, without doing anything at all, your ticket's already paid for. You got a front row seat, VIP. Think about that. But who's going? Well, but the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers, the whoremongers, the sorcerers, the adulterers, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which again is the second death. Fearful, we know what that means. Unbelieving, I just don't believe this. Well, you know, well, I believe Jesus died for me, but you know what, but I'm not ready to take that step. No, I believe, but I want you to know, as we talked about in the book of Acts, come on out Tuesday night, 7:30. You will know that the believers, mother, the believers had signs that followed them. They had power. They had the Holy Ghost. They were baptized, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke in tongues. These signs shall follow them. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. So that means the unbelieving will have their place here. The abominable, the murderers, we know what that means, abomination, doing something just totally, this world is just totally going crazy, being bold about what they're going to do. Whoremongers. Now, we will use that term, I would say the world, people today will use, they'll say whore, they'll say ho. But basically it just means, hey, I won't say just means, but in translation, sleeping around. Having sex outside your marriage or before marriage. So if you are, fellas, if you're going out, you talking to the young shorty, you say, hey, man, can I hit that? Let me get it, yeah. You tapping that dog? Yeah, man, yeah, I tapped that last night. I'm just being real. Okay, sister girl's going out. Yeah, I threw it down on him. Uh-huh. Yeah, I know my man. He coming home because, you know, because I gets it done. And this world is so hooked on whoremongering. The Bible calls it whoremongering or fornication as well. There's even a university that has a national sex day amongst their students. One of the fraternities, one of the groups, we are having a national sex day. Hook up with a partner. Whoremongering. They shall all have their place in the lake of fire. Now, I'm going to show you a few slides here. And Lord willing, this, I'm almost done because I'm running out of slides. But I want you to know that hell is real. The lake of fire is real. Well, how do you know, Pastor? Have you seen it? Have you been there? Well, you know what? The Bible has come to life in so many things. It's proving itself every single day that it is the truth. Prophecy that was written thousands of years ago coming to life today. How many of you all have the tongue talking Holy Ghost? Just like they did in the Bible. These things are coming to pass. Now, I want you to just imagine. I showed you what it will be like waiting to go in that room. And then when you go before the throne room of judgment, and then you hear, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I loved you. I prayed for you. I forgave you when you wouldn't forgive yourself. Before you were even born, I loved you. Before you even sinned, I forgave you for your sin. Depart from me. And my friends, when that day comes, can you imagine the sheer look by the shock of seeing what you're about to take place for in all of eternity? Saints, hell is real. Everybody talks about heaven. Everybody talks about praise God for this, and let's get, God's going to give you a blessing. He's going to give you a new house. He's going to give you a new car. But no one wants to talk about hell. won't take you to hell. They say your sins will find you out. They will find you in hell. Sin. And as I mentioned before, it said, will cast you into hell. Cast you into hell. My prayer, saints, is that no one would go this route. To be tormented. And if you look at this picture here, you will see some, the lady on the edge, not one to go, but being cast in. I'm reminded of a play that a production team put on years ago, If You Missed the Rapture. And how the throne room of judgment, you heard the voice of God, you saw the bright light. And on this door, Brother John, to the right, and they had a door to your left. And it was interesting because it showed all the saints that had prepared themselves, walking in, marching in. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. They walked in with their white, and they sat up judging with Jesus, singing how they made it over. Hallelujah, with joy and happiness as Jesus himself was casting judgment on everyone else. The imps, the angels would come out, and this play was so vivid. They had their black robes on, their hoods, and they stood up. And it's like they came out from nowhere. And they would come up, and they would grab them, and the people were just screaming, "No! No!" Casting them into the lake of fire. And as you can see here, if you look on the edge, you back up from the edge, some people don't even know where they're just going. Just going about their day, not preparing themselves. Oh, I heard about that. Yeah, my granddaddy told me about that a long time ago. It ain't real. It ain't happening. Not realizing that she's going to be like that young woman there that's going to get to the edge when she sees and will be cast in. Saints, hell is real. And once they get in, torment, torture, forever. And forever. It's real, saints. I don't mean to be so, hey, oh, Pastor, we should take it easy because there's kids in here. You know, but you know what? If I was a young man, in which I was, I would much rather somebody tell me the truth. What's waiting for me if I don't wake up? If you know to do right and you choose wrong, sin. The Jewish culture says at the age of 12, 13, when they're able to make a decision and they know right from wrong, that's when they will be judged. But you know what? Doesn't matter to me. My Bible says all liars. So, however theological you want to lean to the side of, that's fine for you. But the point is this, whether I be 11, 12, or 13, or 60, I don't want to go there. With no relief. The Bible says in Revelation 14 that the smoke of these billions of people burning will go up into heaven forever. And it'll be right there in the presence of the angels, the saints, and the Lord. Seeing. I don't know if it's going to smell or what, but just seeing the world. Don't let it be you. I don't want it to be me. Don't think just because I'm here behind the pulpit and I'm talking about it, that I am not exempt from this. As I said, there will be preachers. There will be Sunday school teachers, musicians, choir directors, singers, deacons, because they had iniquity on the side that no one knew about. They were hiding it. Saints, don't let this be you. Sin will take us there. But we thank the Lord. 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2. It's on the playlist, Alexis. Chapter 3 and 9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, Lord, not willing that any should perish, but that all shall come to repentance. My friends, I close it with this today. God has given us all an escape from those eternal flames with repentance, with a repenting heart, a change of mind. You may have been thinking, I'm only here today because I was invited, or my dad may become, my mom may become, my cousin. I was just invited on a whim. But as I told you before, you were on purpose. God has brought you here today for this very message, so that you can see what is to come to your friends, family, and loved ones that have not accepted the Lord. For you to go out and tell them, stop sinning, repent. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Jesus died so that you would not have to go there. He died so that you will never have to experience that horror. He paid the price. And he's saying, repent. He's saying, come to me. I love you so much that I died for you. I love you. He paid the price so that you don't have to go. So you may be asking, well, what do I have to do, brother preacher? What do I have to do? Jesus told his disciples to tell them to repent. Turn away from the wicked things, the sinful things that's going to take me there. If you're lying, if you're having sex, you may have had sex last night. You may have had sex this morning with somebody. You know, it might even be a physical thing. It might be a virtual thing. You might have some type of habit, some type of thing. Whatever it is, I want you to know you are not too far from God. Whatever the sin is, God has already forgiven you. No matter how tough, how hard it is, the blood of Jesus has been shed to forgive you, to wash you from that sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank God for the blood. The blood of Jesus paid your penalty so you don't have to go there. So what do I do, Pastor? Repent. Tell the Lord, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Lord. God, I messed up. I keep on messing up. But God, forgive me. God, I want to make it right. I don't want to go there, Jesus. I don't want to burn. I don't want to die in my sin. Hallelujah. Repent. Turn away from that. Turn away from hell and turn to Jesus. Turn to Jesus. God, I love you. God, you died for me. Forgive me, Jesus. It's with a repenting heart. I don't care what you're addicted to. God's blood is stronger. I don't want you to repent. He says, as we come, we are bringing, you're coming to Jesus like this, God, I'm dirty. God, I got all this sin on me. I got all this filth. God, I got these twisted thoughts in my mind, and my past is dirty. He's saying, bring it to me, son. Bring it to me, daughter. Come this way. I'm going to wash you up. I'm going to clean you up. I will baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sin, to get off that filth. That is why we baptize in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the remission of sins, call upon the name of the Lord, washing away your sins. Read your Bible, it's there. Thank you, Lord. And then Jesus told his disciples, Peter got the message. Once you've been baptized, well, you know, you don't have to even wait till you get baptized. You can receive his Holy Ghost right now. Right now, don't think it's got to be in a pristine order. I got to do this. No. The Lord can fill you with his presence right now. Right now. That. Because what the reason why he did that, because he wants you to go to heaven with him. He wants you to live with him. And he's going to take, we can't take our sinful nature up into a holy place. So he fills us with his presence so that we can go back with him, because that's only, nothing dirty and unclean can get up there. That's why we must be born again of the water and of the Spirit. Receive the Holy Ghost. It's a gift given to you freely. You don't have to do anything else. It's already been paid for. You just have to repent and believe. With a repenting heart and believe, we will pray for you. You will receive the Holy Ghost. If you have a repenting and believing heart. So as we stand on our feet, hallelujah. I don't care if you're first time visitor, second time visitor, or member, drummer, keyboard player, tambourine player, I don't care. You need the Holy Ghost. Come to Jesus.
Hey everybody, it's Pastor Eric. If you like that message and you want to hear more, subscribe to our YouTube page. You'll be glad that you did.